What should we do with the prisoners, Inspector Javert?
Put them in the carriage over there and then double check the sewers for anyone else. I should escort the prisoners.
Yes, sir.
The boy may die, Inspector Javert.
He should have thought of that before he joined the rebels.
Right, you. In the carriage. Now.
Drive on.
Where to, Inspector?
Madelonnette Prison.
Gear it up there.
At least let him die with his own family. I have the address here. Rue des Filles du Calvaire.
Are you questioning my duty, Valjean?
It's me you want, Inspector. Prisoner 24601, not the boy.
Must I repeat myself to you?
I swear that I will give myself up to your jurisdiction without resistance if you will let me take the boy home.
And why should I believe you, 24601? You, a known convict and fugitive, why should I value your word above the word of law after all these years of lies and deception?
Because, Inspector Javert, last night I saved your life.
Have you seen, Father? The barricades have been completely crushed.
And a good thing, too.
Not all of Paris mourns the passing of the rebels.
If I had my way, they'd be strung up outside the Bastille as a lesson to all the other would-be revolutionaries.
As Paris wipes the ashes of the barricades from its eyes and the sun sets over the still empty streets, an unearthly calm settles upon the city.
Was that Marius I saw here the other day?
That ungrateful varlet. I never want to hear his name mentioned ever again.
Of course, Father.
Should that miscreant ever hammer on this door again, send for an exorcist, and then the police.
Aren't you being a little harsh on the boy, Father? He is family.
I tell you, he's no grandson of mine. Imagine wanting to marry some wicked little wench. She's sounding no better than a serving girl. What the devil
is that?
Who
could that be?
Oh, some agitator, I shouldn't wonder. Were I 60 years younger, why, I'd soon show those troublesome apes a thing or two.
Begging your pardon, sir, but I really think you should come with me now.
Have you taken leave of your senses, Basque? Barging in here without...
It's an emergency, sir.
In all his 90 years, Monsieur Gillenormand has never seen a sight the like of which awaits him on his doorstep.
Oh, my God!
The young man needs immediate attention.
Marius! My God, what's happened? Basque, send for a doctor.
Poor Master Marius.
Now, Basque.
Oh, of course, sir. Right away, sir.
Bring him through here, monsieur. He's not dead, is he?
Very near.
My boy. My poor, poor boy.
But, Father, it's Marius. Not a moment ago, you were saying...
Go and fetch some blankets, woman. Can't you see the child is sick?
Of course, Father.
For an hour, the doctor tends to Marius's wounds. And for an hour, the boy dawdles on the threshold of life and death.
Well, Doctor?
With a lot of time and patience, there is a possibility the young gentleman may recover.
Heavens be praised.
But it will not be easy. The young gentleman's wounds are very deep. Where's the man that brought him?
He was sitting over here.
Well, where is he, Basque?
He was sitting just there. I know he was.
Well, find him, Basque. Find him.
Well?
A doctor attends to him.
Driver, proceed.
Does it satisfy you that we're now equals?
Showing compassion is not a crime, Inspector.
But defying the law is. By rights, that man should be behind bars, and yet I have released him.
What difference if the man dies in prison or with his family?
Because only the innocent and pure of heart should die peacefully in their beds. The rest of us must perish in ignominy.
You did the right thing, Inspector. I'm sure the young man would thank you if he could.
Last night he would have seen me gutted like a fish. Tell me, Valjean, why did you release me?
I did what I knew was right, Inspector. Nothing more.
What do you know of right? For 15 years, not one day passed that I did not seek to have you arrested.
I don't know what to say, Inspector.
The law demands justice. You broke your parole. The very day you took that silver from the Bishop of Dean, you must have known that the law would never rest, that the law would do everything in its power to make you account for your crimes.
Yes, Inspector, I knew.
You see, a criminal like you can never change. You are what you are. You existing on one side of the law and me existing on the other. We both have our roles. But last night you held my life in your hands and yet you released me.
The truth is that from the moment I saw you a hostage in the barricades, my instinct was to release you. I'm sorry if that's not the answer you want, Inspector, but it's the truth.
Such lies, Valjean.
I'm not lying.
Then I am in your debt, and you have your victory.
What victory? You have me in chains, Inspector.
You have corrupted me, Valjean. I have defied the law. And now I must bear the consequences of my crime.
This is madness.
You mock me, just as you have always done. I remember you in the galleys.
A long time ago.
I opposed your parole, Valjean, from the very day it was first mentioned. Why? Because of the inescapable logic of your criminality. And now you think yourself above the law, don't you?
No, Inspector, never.
When you turned up as mayor in Montreuil-sur-Mer, dispensing good works and charity, what did you think? Did you think that you could fool me? I smelt your criminality like a stench in the air. And then, when you paraded yourself with that whore, Fantine, even taking it into your home as your own, hardly better than a pimp.
You will speak of Fantine with respect.
Ah, now we have it. Go on, Virgil, go on. Strike me!
To you, I am, and always will be, whatever you decide I am. What's the point you never understand?
Never understand what?
That with God's help, a person may change.
You dare speak his name!
I do.
I ask you again, Valjean, why didn't you kill me?
Because it is wrong.
Last night at the barricades, order defeated anarchy, crushed it like an insect under its boot. I was ready to sacrifice myself for justice. And yet here I am alive with the criminal who spared me. And now, in this carriage, anarchy defeats order. And I must seek justice in the gutter.
You haven't touched the soup. I made it specially.
What?
Life must go on, Cosette.
There is no life without them.
I won't have you speak like that, my girl.
Why?
Because it's no good.
Stop here, driver.
What are you doing?
Overpower me and run away.
No.
I'm giving you an opportunity to escape.
So that you can continue to hunt me, and we might re-establish this so-called logic of yours. I don't think so, Inspector Javert.
Then what do you want?
All I ask is that I may go back to my lodgings and make some provision for my dependents.
And then?
Then you may do with me as you will.
Don't you care that they may both be dead too, sir?
Of course I do. But I also know that wanting to die yourself is no way to deal with it.
But
nothing is for certain. We must wait and see, no matter how terrible the outcome may be.
You don't understand, Toussaint.
I understand very well. If you think that you are the only one who will mourn his death, then you should think again, my girl.
But what are we to do if he's gone?
When terrible things occur, we must do what people have always done, Cosette. We must carry on.
Cosette.
Father!
Sir! Heavens be praised!
Are you all right? Did they hurt you?
I'm all right, Cosette.
But your clothes! Toussaint, prepare a bath.
Cosette.
There's soup, isn't there, Toussaint?
Fresh on the stove, but I think you need a bath first, sir.
Listen, both of you. I can't stay long. There's a carriage outside which is waiting to take me to prison.
Prison?
What have you done?
I fought at the barricades, which is an offence against the king.
Then we must help you escape.
No, no more running. No more hiding.
Toussaint and I were at the barricades looking for you.
That was dangerous, Cosette.
They said there were no survivors.
Are all the rebels dead?
Everyone. And now, just when we have you back, you say you're to be arrested.
Try and understand, Cosette.
No, Father. As usual, I don't understand anything about you. And as usual, you will do what you please, even if it means allowing them to execute you.
There isn't time for this,
Cosette. I thought you were dead, Father. And now you come back only to tell me that you may as well be.
Cosette.
Let's don't just stand there, Basque.
But I don't know what Monsieur wants.
Can't you see he's coughing?
Yes, but I still don't know.
You don't care if he lives or dies, do you?
The master is
dying. I know you think I drove Marius away. Well, I didn't. He left. And why? Politics. Detestable politics. From now on, politics is not to be discussed in this house. Is that understood?
Yes, sir.
What can I get you, my boy? My darling boy. Oh, listen to him groan, Basque. I can't bear it. I can't.
In this box, you'll find money. Use it to leave Paris and start a new life abroad.
Without you?
Without me.
Never. This makes no sense. Just a moment ago, you said there was to be no more hiding.
You may not be safe here, that's all.
But, Father, it's not us who are in danger, it's you.
All I want is your security.
And we shall have it. The three of us, together. Please don't go, Father. I'm begging you.
Oh.
I have given my word.
Then we shall stay here, counting the days until your return, won't we, Toussaint?
We will, sir.
And now, for the second time in less than 24 hours, Jean Valjean delivers himself up to God's mercy. Will Javert see him hang this time? Without a doubt. Valjean knows this as surely as the river knows the sea.
Where did you say that carriage was?
Right here. Right outside the door.
Well, there's no sign of it now.
There must be.
The street is completely deserted.
Pont au Change, Inspector.
Good. You may go now. The police station will settle the account.
The lights of Paris twinkle on the surface of the river's dark swirling water.
Very good, sir. Are you all right, sir?
Just go.
But Javert's universe of an unimpeachable law and all its certainties has disappeared, as surely as if the moon and stars have slipped from the sky.
My hat! What does it matter if you lose a hat when God himself laughs at you?
And here now, alone on this desolate bridge, Javert extends his arms as if Paris herself were slipping from his grasp.
I only sought to do my duty. Only that. So how did I fail? How did I fail?
Feeling today? A little stronger, perhaps?
Oh, bad dreams. Such bad dreams.
They will pass, Marius. They will pass. Shall I open the shutters? The garden's magnificent this afternoon. Just magnificent.
I'd like that.
Voila!
And Marius is bathed in the soft orange glow of an August afternoon. The apple trees sway in the gossamer breeze, heavy with precious fruit. Butterflies and bees scurry from flower to flower.
I keep going over and over that night on the barricades.
You must rest, Marius. Rest.
Monsieur Gillenormand has forbidden any mention of politics in his house.
Bonjour, Grantaire. Confer, I dreamt that all of them were dead.
Try not to distress yourself.
I must go to them.
You can't go to them, my child.
Why not?
Because, Marius, your friends are dead.
Dead?
They were all killed that night.
But what about the revolution? What happened to the revolution?
There was no revolution. Now get back to bed.
But all those brave men, Those brave, brave men.
We'll talk about them later, Marius. Later, I promise. Won't you take a little champagne for me?
Did you know Inspector Javert?
I met him a couple of times.
Who would have thought?
He was a dedicated policeman, wasn't he?
None more so.
But the Seine's dark, swirling water keeps its secrets.
Did he jump from here?
That's what the report said. Comes here in this carriage the night after the revolt in Lasalle and jumps.
Secured away for all eternity.
You've been very kind, officer.
I'll leave you to it then, sir. Good day.
Thank you, officer. Who's there?
But only the deep, cold water answers.
Am I free of you at last, Javert? Will I ever be free of you? Or will you hound me forever?
As it races out of Paris, toward the sea so far, far away.
Goodbye, Javert.
Occasionally, memory is like water, as it rushes to fill every available crevice and space.
Look out, Enjolras. Look out, Enjolras.
But in the comfort and safety of his grandfather's house, Marius drowns each night beneath a tidal wave of nightmare and memory.
Gavroche, come back! Oh, Gavroche!
As in his dreams he sees his comrades and friends fall before the onslaught of the guardsman's cannon over and over again.
They're all dead, Cosette. All of them. They're all dead. Oh, dear God, what's happening to me? I just don't know who I am anymore. I just don't know.
Marius. Where are you, Marius?
It hardly seems possible. But the garden of the Rue Plumet is now even more overgrown than it was a few months ago.
If only you knew how I long for you. How I wish that you were here. Who's there?
Remember a dark wood on a cold Christmas Eve many years before.
I said, who's that?
Is that you, Cosette?
Father?
What are you doing here? I've been looking for you.
I wanted to see the old house again.
And the garden, perhaps?
The garden, too.
Master Marius should try not to distress himself so.
I just want to read a book.
Your grandfather has expressly forbidden it. He says you are not to be overstimulated.
I'm bored.
Is there something I can arrange for you, sir? Your pillows, perhaps?
Has there been any news about... has anyone come looking for me?
Looking for you, sir?
No one has inquired after me.
Is Master Marius referring to anyone in particular?
Well, I...
A young lady, perhaps?
Well, what do you know of her?
Nothing, sir. Only I've heard you call out a name in your sleep. Colette, is it?
Cosette! Has there been any news of her?
Unfortunately, no.
She wouldn't be welcome here anyway.
Oh, no, sir. I'm sure she would.
I wanted to marry her.
Oh, how romantic, Master Marius.
But my esteemed grandfather suggested I take her as my mistress.
Occasionally, the master says things that he doesn't really mean. We both know that.
She probably thinks I'm dead. Killed with all the others.
Now, Master Marius isn't to fill his head with such things. Dark thoughts are forbidden. Those are your grandfather's orders.
I don't know what you want me to say, Father.
Toussaint says you used to spend a lot of time out here in the evenings.
What else has Toussaint said?
Nothing.
Really?
Really?
She's told you something, hasn't she?
Nothing. I only asked her why you seemed so sad.
And what did she say?
She said I should ask you. Is there something you want to tell me, Cosette? Very well.
I never wanted to deceive you, Father.
Deceive me? What are you talking about, Cosette?
I suppose it doesn't matter now.
I don't understand.
A young man used to visit me here.
When?
It feels like 1,000 years ago. You must believe I wanted to tell you.
I don't understand.
Do you remember when we used to take an afternoon walk in the Luxembourg Gardens?
Very well.
And every day we used to sit on a bench beside the fountain?
Yes.
Well, there was a young man. He used to sit opposite us.
I vaguely remember someone.
Go on.
One afternoon, he didn't come back to the bench. For years, I didn't see him. I thought he must have forgotten me until one night. One joyous night. He found me once again. This is distressing you, isn't it, Father?
No, no. Continue, please.
We used to meet here in secret, in this marvelous garden. His name was Marius Pontmercy. You must believe me when I say I wanted to tell you all the time, but I thought you would be angry. Oh, not that it matters now. He's dead.
Dead?
He fought at the barricades. None of the students survived.
Oh, Cosette.
If I hadn't left this place, then...
You have nothing to reproach yourself for.
Don't I?
Of course not. That Valjean could only bring himself to comfort her. But wildly he hopes to his shame that Cosette might have forgotten about Baron Marius Pontmercy.
3 months ago I thought I had lost you both. And now it's as if I have lost myself.
Was this young man serious in his intentions?
And now he hears it from her own lips.
He asked me to be his wife.
And did you accept his proposal?
With all my heart. And now he's dead.
Do you trust me, Cosette?
Oh, of course.
Then dry your tears and come with me.
I don't understand.
Come with me.
And you believe this will work, do you, Basque?
I would not be so bold, sir, but I do think that we should at least try and find the girl.
That would be all very well if we had the slightest inkling as to what she looked like.
Marius has described her to me.
Go on.
Golden ringlets. Hmm? A French face, but with a touch of Italian in the complexion.
Yes.
Dark eyes. Yeah. Bewitching eyes. Petite, but not thin. And well-dressed. Very well-dressed.
So we're looking for a pretty, petite, well-dressed Parisian girl, are we?
Exactly.
And how many young girls fitting exactly that description do you imagine are walking around Paris this very instant?
Well,
I am surrounded by dunderheads and blockheads. What about the man who brought Marius home that night? What news of him?
Well, sir, it seems that nobody has ever heard of him.
Every day, poor Basque is dispatched to search the streets of Paris for a sighting or an inkling as to the identity of the mysterious visitor who saved Marius's life.
What are you saying, Basque?
It seems he just vanished. Vanished into thin air, like a ghost.
Like a ghost? I never heard such nonsense. There must be someone who knows him.
There's no one, sir, I swear.
But every day it is the same. Nothing. Only whispers and rumours that in the aftermath of that terrible night, a police inspector inexplicably threw himself from the Pont au Change.
Put on your coat and go and look for him. Now.
Now, sir? But what about Master Marius?
I shall attend personally to Master Marius. Go!
What are you doing, Father?
Leaving a note for Toussaint. I don't want her worrying. Are you ready?
But where are we going?
Come along.
I don't want any chicken.
But you haven't eaten properly in days.
I should be dead.
No, Marius.
Along with all my comrades.
Don't you see that when you speak this way, you break my heart, my boy?
You sent me away.
No.
You denied everything I was, and you turned me away when I asked for your help.
I only wanted to do the best.
You never even told me the truth about my father. About Baron Pontmercy, a title I am still proud to claim as my own.
I will not speak of that swashbuckler.
He was a hero, honored by Napoleon himself. I won't have him spoken of with disrespect.
Ungrateful boy. Who fed and clothed you? Who nurtured you as if you were his own? I did.
As long as I never questioned you. As long as I played my part of the somber royalist in every particular.
I will not discuss politics. It was politics which drove us apart in the first place.
Brave men died for freedom on that barricade. Brave men that you and I are not worthy to clean the boots of.
Why are you provoking me, Marius?
My name is Baron Pontmercy,
And while I am grateful to you for my recovery, I would appreciate it if you could instruct Basque to gather my things.
You don't know what you're saying, Marius.
I shall leave this evening.
But where will you go? You're still not well.
That is no concern of yours, monsieur.
At least let us discuss this sensibly. Basque!
As far as I am concerned, there is nothing to discuss.
Basque! Must a gentleman answer his own front door? Where are the servants?
The endless strife of young and old.
I'm coming. I'm coming.
Always blind to one another's needs.
Wipe away those tears, you fool. Yes, may I help you? The tradesman's entrance is at the side.
Go away.
Who can underestimate the furious obstinacy of youth?
Who is it?
Marius, please.
I do not wish to speak with you. I told you I'm leaving, and this time for good.
Please, Marius, let me come in.
No.
It will only take a moment, please, my boy.
Well?
You're right, of course.
What?
Well, leave if you must. I will not stop you. As soon as Basque returns, I will have him pack what bags you need.
I beg your pardon.
I will not stand in your way, my boy.
I am, of course, grateful for the kindness which you have shown me.
I trust you will consider visiting your grandfather and aunt every so often.
If I have an opportunity.
I would be very grateful.
Well, then.
There's just one thing more.
What is it?
As a favor to an old man.
Yes?
Would you please open the door?
Why?
Please, as a favor to me.
If this is some ruse to make me stay...
I assure you, it is not.
Am I dreaming?
Oh, my love, you're alive.
Oh, Cosette!
Marius, you're alive! You're alive! Is this the Gillenormand household?
It is.
Would you be so kind as to inform the master of the house that Lafayette is here?
Madame Lafayette, it will be an honor.
In the weeks since their reunion, neither Marius and Cosette nor the Gillenormand house have known such happiness.
There's nothing to be nervous about, my love.
But what if I don't like it?
Grandfather says that Madame Lafayette is the finest seamstress in Paris.
I just want the dress to be perfect.
And it will be. You'll see.
Begging Master Marius's pardon.
What is it, Basque?
Madame Lafayette is here.
Is the fitting room prepared?
It is, sir.
Inform Madame Lafayette that Cosette will be with her in a moment.
The ancient furniture and fittings, so long a neglected mausoleum to a more graceful age, are now awakened as if from a long and laborious sleep. Even the horror of the barricades is faded away like smoke from a distant fire, to be replaced by a tenderness not known in the Gillenormand house for over 70 years.
And breathe in. And breathe out. Silk for you, young lady. Definitely silk.
And lace?
Lace! Of course. Goes without saying.
You wanted to see me, monsieur?
Yes, Baron, I did.
Well?
It concerns Cosette's dowry and fortune.
What about it?
I think it best you sit down.
If a traveller is ever in the woods outside the town of Montfermeil, he may notice a wizened tree.
Cosette knows that I do not expect
Please
her...
Please listen.
It is under this tree, where the roots are at their thickest, that Jean Valjean hid the fortune he acquired as the proprietor of the factories at Montreuil-sur-Mer so many years before.
Please, open this parcel, Baron.
This is very irregular, Monsieur Fauchelevent. Oh, my. How much is there?
584,000 francs.
584?
It is Cosette's.
Cosette has never mentioned
it. Cosette does not know. The money was held in trust by me until such a time as she was to be married.
I don't know what to say.
And it is to that tree that Jean Valjean returns every few weeks and retrieves such money as he needs, just as he has done for the last 10 years.
But this is a very great fortune, monsieur.
I know.
And Cosette knows nothing?
Not a thing.
But how did this come to be?
I assure you it is all entirely above board.
I don't know what to say.
Please, say nothing. Only permit me to wish long life and happiness to you both.
I must tell Cosette. My goodness, Monsieur Fauchelevent, I don't know what to say. Yes, I...
Perhaps I might speak with your grandfather.
Of course, of course.
And soon, the entire household is talking about Cosette's unexpected fortune.
Not only is Cosette the most beautiful and enchanting girl an old man could hope to meet, but by Jupiter, she's also a millionairess, as good as.
Well, what do we really know about this man and his so-called daughter?
What we know is that she and Marius are hopelessly in love.
Well, I don't mind telling you that I don't like it.
And I don't mind telling you that Marius is getting married in 2 weeks' time, and I don't want any of your sour grapes spoiling the day.
Sour grapes? I have kept this house for you, Father, for 40 years. I have slaved night and day to make it comfortable, to make it a place where you could enjoy the twilight of your life in peace.
Please, daughter, have a glass of champagne, and let's celebrate our family's happiness and good fortune. Please, for your poor old father.
Well, where are the lovebirds to live?
Here, of course.
Here?
I have the decorators coming in tomorrow.
The decorators?
It will be perfect, just perfect. All the family under one roof.
Tell me about the fitting, Cosette.
Madame Lafayette says she has made me a dress a queen would be proud of.
A queen, eh? Queen Cosette of Paris.
Actually, she's pretty formidable. But seriously, Father, tell me. How did I come into such a fortune? It can't have come from old Monsieur Fauchelevent at the convent.
A little patience, that's all I ask.
It's just so hard to believe. 584,000 francs. How?
All in good time, Cosette, all in good time. But shouldn't you be in bed? I'm sure Baron Pommercy won't appreciate it if his exhausted bride starts snoring at the altar.
Oh, Basque.
Could sir hold his head still? We wouldn't want the ribbon to stray, would we?
Where are the carriages?
I'm sure they're on their way.
They should have been here an hour ago.
I know, sir, but it's Mardi Gras. The streets are packed. Now, if you'll just stay absolutely still as I thread this through here...
Do I have to remind you that the Baron and his bride are to be married today?
Yes, but the revelers in the streets don't know that.
What insolence. Get that carriage here this instant. And where are the flowers?
It's all in hand, sir.
Are they decorating the dining room without me? I want to oversee the arrangements. Everything must be perfect.
Yes, madame.
Get in here immediately and sort out the cutlery. The footman's made an awful hash of it.
Can't you see? He's doing my hair.
It's very inconvenient.
A mirror. Hand me a mirror. If my ribbon isn't straight, you'll rue the day, Basque.
As sir will observe, the ribbon is sitting perfectly, just as always.
What a day, Basque. The young master to be married, his bride as lovely lovely. Could it be better, Basque?
The household is in ecstasy, sir.
It is, isn't it?
I don't think I can remember a happier day.
But where are those carriages?
What have you done to your hand, Father?
It's nothing. You look wonderful, Cosette.
But it's wrapped up in a sling.
The dress is enchanting.
How did it happen?
It's just a sprain. But unfortunately, it means that I shall have to ask Monsieur Gillenormand to escort you up the aisle.
Monsieur Gillenormand? Why won't you be doing it?
With my arm like this, I'm sorry, Cosette.
Father.
Trust me, better this way.
And now a ghastly chill spreads its way through Jean Valjean's heart as he imagines the bitter laughter of Inspector Javert.
Are you in any pain?
No, no. A little stiffness, that's all.
But Valjean knows, as certainly as winter brings snow, that convict 24601 will never be worthy to give away the bride that he has nurtured and protected all these years.
Oh, Father, listen. The wedding bells.
Will never be worthy.
Come along, Cosette. We don't want to be late, do we?
Not if he were to live for 1,000 years.
But what if the carriage doesn't turn up?
Of course it will turn up.
You're right. I know you're right.
It's been a very long time since you said that, my boy.
Said what, Grandfather?
That I was right in any matter.
Oh, you know how grateful both Cosette and I are, especially now that you've allowed us to live here.
Grateful? A fiddlesticks. It's I that should be grateful that the merciful fate saw fit to deliver you back to my door alive. Oh, bother, bother. I mustn't have tears, or the rouge will spoil.
And you're not angry that I shall be keeping my father's title?
The carriages are here.
Wish me luck.
You don't need any luck, my boy, shall we?
Ah, Mardi Gras. All over Paris, cheers are given to a very different rebellion which now dances down these teeming streets. A rebellion of colour.
Zelma!
What is it, Dad?
Did you manage to pick them pockets?
The rogue Thénardier is even thinner and more venomous than before.
There's talk of a fancy wedding party passing this way on their way to Notre Dame.
Observe him now, as he and his only surviving daughter, Azelma, now even brawnier than before, trawl through the unsuspecting crowd.
Well, what are we waiting for, my elf? Pass us that mask, yep. And let's join in the fun.
There it is. Some carriages over there.
Well, it might as well be made of solid gold. We got a real princess here.
I always wanted to get married like that, in style.
Shut up, Azelma. We've got work to do.
Oh, Father, what if he decides he doesn't want to marry me right at the last minute?
Baron Pontmercy loves you completely.
He does, doesn't he?
Yes, Cosette, he does.
And you are happy for us, aren't you, Father?
With all my heart.
What's that?
And who have we here?
What can we do for you, Monsieur Harlequin?
Harlequin? I've never been so insulted. I am the Count of Saint-Germain, come to wish a beautiful bride condolences on her wedding day.
Did you hear that, Father? He wished us his condolences.
What can we do for you, Count?
Well, perhaps, sir. Mademoiselle has a penny for a poor rogue, for as the noble saying goes, a penny from a bride is a very lucky penny indeed, etc., etc.
Father?
Here you are. Ah. Is something wrong, Count?
Yes. Wait, something wrong? No. I thought for a moment. Well, never mind.
Then take your penny.
Ah. 10 francs. Oh, monsieur! He's too kind! Too kind!
What are you doing, Basque?
I'm waving, sir.
Well, stop it at once. We are not commoners.
Sir.
Every inch of the church is garlanded with flowers, and every face is beaming with joy.
This is a most irregular request, Monsieur Fauchelevent.
As you see, I cannot use my left arm.
But the bride must be given away by her father. It is tradition.
I honestly think it's for the best.
Well, if you insist, but this is very irregular.
You're doing me a great honor, sir.
It is I that am honored.
If you are sure, Father.
Let's not keep the groom waiting any longer, Cosette.
Isn't the church beautiful?
Monsieur Gillenormand, if you would be so kind.
Certainly. Are you ready, my dear?
Goodbye, Father. I shall see you after the mass.
We shall proceed.
Goodbye, Cosette.
Oi, Azelma!
Dad! Did the bride give you something?
Well, a couple of francs.
Oh, typical.
Now, come on. I want to get a better look at that wedding party.
Why?
Come on.
And now I pronounce you man and wife. Baron Pontmercy, you may kiss the bride.
As Marius and Cosette kiss for the first time as man and wife,
I love you, Cosette.
A brighter and more hopeful future dawns in the hearts of all present.
And I love you, Marius.
There they are, Father, coming out of the church.
I thought so.
Thought what, Dad?
You see that big man behind the bride?
No.
With his arm in a sling.
What about him?
I recognize him. That night I was down the sewers, the night of the trouble at the barricades.
Oh, you must be mistaken.
No, Azelma, I'm not mistaken. Only that night, he had a corpse over his shoulder. And by the look of that wedding, it looks like he's got himself in with a crowd that'll pay handsomely to keep the lid on such a... what shall we say? Sensitive information.
Is Monsieur all right?
Quite all right, thank you, Basque.
In a room off the sumptuous banqueting hall, Jean Valjean sits alone.
A glass of something, perhaps?
Nothing, thank you.
His mind fills with memories of Cosette as a child.
I think we're almost ready for the speeches.
Of all the things he yearns to tell her, but cannot.
I'll come through in a moment.
Perhaps Sir's arm is causing him some discomfort.
My arm?
In the sling, sir.
Oh, my arm. No. It's nothing.
Of how she must always be protected from the truth.
You carry on. I'll follow you in a moment.
Change? A felon like you? Not a hope.
Inspector Javert. Am I truly cursed forever?
Cursed forever. Ladies and gentlemen, may I have your attention? Let me begin with a question. Can there be too much love in the world? If one says there is, one may as well condemn a butterfly in its flight or a flower in its bed. Let us look around us, ladies and gentlemen, and consider these two glorious young people whose nuptials we celebrate today. Stand up, Marius and Cosette. Stand up.
Grandfather, really.
To separate one from the other, one may as well separate the sunlight from the daytime, or deny the ocean its river. Isn't that right, Monsieur Fauchelevent? Dear, where is Monsieur Fauchelevent?
Over here. And yes, you are quite right.
Marius and Cosette, I thank you. I thank you for coming home to us. I thank you for finding each other, and I thank you for making an old man joyous in his dotage. Ladies and gentlemen, raise your glasses to the happy couple, Marius and Cosette.
Marius and Cosette.
Speech! Might I add that on behalf of my wife and I would like to thank my grandfather for preparing this exquisite feast for us today.
Bravo!
Yes, indeed.
And to thank the mystical fates which led us to each other. To my darling Cosette, my thanks and love.
Bravo!
And finally, to thank the mysterious stranger who saved my life 9 months ago.
Yes.
If it had not been for this unknown man's bravery and kindness, we would not be sitting here today.
Not even a flicker passes across Jean Valjean's face as he quietly slips from the room.
So, I ask you to raise your glasses.
Yeah.
To absent friends.
To absent friends.
Father?
What are you doing here, Cosette?
I came to see if you're all right. Don't you like the party?
Oh, there are too many people for this old man to deal with.
You're not old, Father. You're not as old as Monsieur Gillenormand. He's nearly 90 and he's dancing a jig in there.
To each his own.
Marius tells me you've decided not to live here with us.
That is correct.
But why? We have a room for you.
It's not right.
Why isn't it right?
Because it isn't.
You're not making sense again.
Cosette!
Won't you come back inside?
You go on.
I can't bear the thought of you sitting out here in the dark on your own.
I'm not on my own.
Cosette! Where are you, Cosette?
Your husband's calling you.
Whatever would I do without you, Father?
Cosette!
Quickly. The Baron will worry.
We'll talk more about this later. Coming, my love! Coming!
Basque.
Yes, sir.
Fetch more champagne.
Immediately, sir. If I may say so, sir, they make a charming couple.
They do, don't they? Perfect.
I think this is one of the happiest days of my life, sir.
You're not going to blub, are you, Basque?
No, sir.
Because I won't have blubbing.
No, sir. Would sir like his handkerchief?
Yes, sir. And my rouge.
No. Well, he's knocked next door.
Father! Where is he? The guests are leaving.
I'll have Basque try and hunt him down, but now we really should be making our goodbyes.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Unlike the English, who conspire to have the bride and groom whisked away from their own party as soon as possible, Cosette and Marius continue dancing until their very last guest departs.
Sleep well, my dears. Sleep well.
Shall I put some more coal on the fire?
I'm quite warm enough. Unless you're cold.
No. No, I'm not cold. I'd have loved... I love you, Cosette.
And I love you, Marius.
In what seems a blink of an eye, their first weeks of marriage fly by.
Marius, do you think this material is suitable for the curtains in the morning room?
It's very soft and smooth, isn't it?
It is. Oh, Marius, not here.
On the 1st of March, as buds appear on the apple trees and the returning birds build nests in the chimney pots, a coach pulls up outside 7 Rue des Filles du Calvaire.
Monsieur Fauchelevent.
I hope I haven't called at an inconvenient time.
Not at all. I'm delighted to see you. I'll call Cosette.
No, it's you I came to see, Baron Pontmercy.
Marius, please. Another surprise, perhaps.
I think it better if you sit down.
Well, now I'm sitting, Monsieur Fauchelevent.
My name is not Fauchelevent.
Not Fauchelevent? What is it, then?
My name is Jean Valjean.
But surely this is all some fantastic story.
I swear it is all true.
But I don't understand. First you were a criminal, then you were mayor of Montreux...
Montreuil-sur-Mer.
Does Cosette know anything of this?
Nothing.
I find it hard to believe that she knows nothing of your background.
She knows only that I saved her from the Thénardiers. She knows nothing of my fortune or my pursuit by Inspector Javert and the law. Nor does she know that I've lived as a fugitive for the last 15 years.
I'm sorry, but I simply don't understand. You, a criminal.
A long time ago. I only came here to tell you the truth as I have never told it to anyone.
Then your whole life is a lie.
In one way, yes.
Well, what other way is there? Either it is or it isn't.
I have always been honest in all my dealings with the world. Only my identity has been secret.
But surely you are no longer a fugitive. Javert is dead. Nobody hunts you now. You are free.
A convict is never free. For as long as I live, I will always have the errors of my past at my shoulder, constantly reminding me of the criminal that I was.
Well, then why are you telling me this?
Because Cosette is your wife now, and no longer my daughter. I cannot describe how I've tried to tear all fatherly feeling from my breast, to just let her go, to move away quietly and leave you both to the rest of your lives. But I couldn't. I couldn't.
But nobody has asked you to.
You don't understand, Baron. I can no longer live pretending that the stigma of my past will simply fade away. I can only hope that when you know the truth of what I am, you will decide on the best course to take.
We offered you a home here. We invited you to join our family. And now you come here and calmly throw it all back in our face.
Family? I don't know the meaning of that word. Cosette was all I had.
And what about Cosette's inheritance?
The money is hers, honestly acquired.
Am I to take your word on that after everything you've just said?
I know that may be difficult.
Difficult? Do you have any idea of the situation you now put me in? I have only your word, the word of a felon, that this money was honestly acquired. Am I to expect the police to come banging on the door at any instant?
You must trust me in this.
Trust you?
Why are you shouting? Father! You didn't tell us you were coming.
Would you excuse us, my love?
Excuse you? Why? What's wrong? Why the long faces?
Your father and I are discussing matters of some sensitivity, Cosette. Private matters.
You're not going away again.
No, Cosette.
Then what's going on?
We'll talk about it later.
Why can't we talk about it now?
Please, Cosette.
All right. But you must promise to tell me later, Marius.
I will.
We'll speak soon, won't we, Father?
We will, Cosette. Goodbye.
Goodbye.
Perhaps I can talk to my grandfather. He still has some influential friends. Arrange some sort of reprieve.
It is too late for that.
Then you leave me no choice, Monsieur Valjean. I think it best that you no longer see Cosette. She is my wife now and shares my title.
Forgive me, Baron. But if I were never to see her, then my life... Well, then my life would be over. Perhaps I might visit occasionally, in the evenings, under cover of the night.
Very well. You may visit Cosette in the evenings, but only at a prearranged time. I never wish to see you or have any dealings with you ever again. Is that understood?
It is, sir.
Very well, then. Good day.
What have you found out, Azelma?
Only that the wedding couple now live on the Rue des Filles de Calvaire, Baron and Baroness Pontmercy. Nobody seems to know the old bloke in the carriage.
That's because we're asking all the right questions to all the wrong people.
Well, who should we be asking then?
That bloke's a villain. Somehow he's got himself mixed up in high society.
Maybe he's got something on him.
Spanish Henri. Of course.
What, Dad?
Never you mind, Azelma. Come on.
Not call you father. Why ever not?
Because now that you are married, it is no longer appropriate.
I don't understand. I've never understood. You've always kept things from me. And now you want to exile yourself from my affections.
No, Cosette, it's not like that.
Then what is it like? How could I possibly forget you?
How Valjean longs to comfort her.
Are you leaving?
I think it best. I shall come back tomorrow.
We have him, Azelma. We have him.
Well, what did Spanish Henri say, Dad?
He told me a story, didn't he? About an old lag who broke his parole and somehow became mayor of a town up north.
Well, what about it?
What about it? The man as was down the sewers is the same man in the wedding coach.
But we know that already.
Panama City. Here we come.
What are you talking about, Dad?
Come on, Azelma. I need to find me a tailor if I'm to pay a visit on the noble Baron Pontmercy.
Marius.
What is it, Cosette?
Father hasn't come.
Well, perhaps he's been delayed.
And why isn't the fire lit in the cellar?
I thought it best to economize.
Economize? You know that Father and I speak in there every night.
It will be relit.
Has he said anything to you?
Nothing. Don't upset yourself, my love.
Why doesn't he want me to call him Father anymore? He said you knew.
Cosette, there's no need
to... Well, do you? Why doesn't anyone tell me anything?
Please, Cosette. I'm sure he'll be here very soon. I'm sure he will.
sir. I wish you'd go and see a doctor.
Stop fussing, Toussaint. I'm quite all right.
Of course you are, sir. Mere skin and bone can be described as rude health.
Where's my hat?
Where are you going?
Out. I need some air.
Oh. Well, Azelma. How do I look?
Oh, proper gentleman, I'm sure.
It won't be long before the money's in our pockets and we're on a ship for Panama City.
Yeah, but what if they don't pay up?
After Baron Pommer sees her, but I have to tell him, they'll be begging us to take the money.
All morning, Thénardier has attempted to disguise his cunning under a faded yellow suit and a pair of green-tinted glasses.
The plan is foolproof, Azelma. If there's one thing the rich fear, it is scandal. You mark my words.
Oh. Are you listening to me, Marius?
Of course I am. I just want to finish this letter to my bank.
I'm really worried about Father. He doesn't answer my letters, and when I sent Basque around to the house, Toussaint said that he'd gone away. It just doesn't make any sense. Could he be worried about money? That's not like him. Father never worried about money, especially now we have the inheritance.
Ever since learning of Jean Valjean's criminal past, Marius has been very cautious of Cosette's dowry and fortune. The thought that it might be a criminal's ill-gotten spoils, an anathema.
We'll talk about this later, I promise. Now, I really must finish this letter.
Why won't you tell me what's going on?
Come! Oh, what is it, Basque?
There's a gentleman at the door who asks to see you urgently.
Who is he?
He didn't give his name.
What the devil? I'm sorry, Cosette.
We'll finish this later, Marius.
Very well, Basque. Show the gentleman into the study.
Monsieur Fauchelevent!
Oh, Toussaint.
What on earth happened to you, sir? Did you fall?
Some children were teasing me. One of them knocked me over.
Vicious little devils.
Can we go inside?
Oh, sir. Oh. I can't bear to see you in pain.
Oh, be fine. You'll see.
Take my arm.
Thank you.
Ever since the wedding, you've been a different man, sir.
The street is not the place to have this conversation, Toussaint.
Well, if you ate your dinner when I gave it to you, none of this would happen. Oh, honestly, sir, you're not well. You've aged these last few weeks. Sometimes I barely recognize you. At least let me send word to Cosette.
No, Toussaint, I don't want her alarmed.
But, sir...
Enough.
This is incredible, monsieur. Please, go on.
This so-called gentleman who attended your wedding was none other than a wanted thief and murderer.
I see.
Although Marius affects disinterest, excitement rises within his breast. Could this curious gentleman in green-tinted spectacles be about to disclose the identity of the man who saved his life?
I know this because he had one of his victims over his shoulder at the time I saw him.
And you are sure this victim was dead?
Oh, yes, sir. Dead as dead can be. Fish-eyed. Oh, terrible.
And this man was at my wedding, you say?
He was, sir.
His name?
Are you sure there's no one here to overhear us?
We are quite alone.
It's a wanted criminal by the name of Jean Valjean.
Jean Valjean?
Yes, sir.
The name sweeps through Marius's soul like fire.
You're absolutely sure his name was Jean Valjean?
Oh, I'd swear it on my late wife's grave.
How could he have been so blind and callous? How could he have treated him with such blind suspicion and cruelty?
And what is your purpose in bringing me this information today?
Oh, I see Sirwood prefers to talk directly. Man to man, as it were.
I would.
Well then, to keep this information from falling into the wrong hands, I am prepared to dispose of it in such a way as that it never existed.
Dispose of it? How? Speak frankly, sir.
Well, it's long been a cherished dream to restart my life in Panama City. The Americas, it seems, were designed for a gentleman like me.
Go on.
10,000 francs makes that dream a reality. It's a small price to pay for peace of mind. I'm sure you'll agree.
The day is overcast and damp. Grey clouds press upon Paris, and the light in Marius's study is weak and murky. But still there is something very familiar about this rattlesnake who passes for a man.
Don't I know you, sir?
Oh, I don't think so, sir.
Look closely at my face.
Well, I'm sure sir doesn't suffer the misfortune to mix in my less than salubrious circles, etc., etc.
Would it interest you to know that my father was Baron Pommercy and that he fought at the Battle of Waterloo?
Oh, well, it's very commendable, I'm sure.
Don't you recognise the name?
No, I can't say as I do. I knew a Pommery. I pulled him from a pile of bodies.
Were you stealing from him at the time?
What a suggestion!
Your name is not Thénard, is it?
What?
It's Thénardier, and you also go by a number of aliases.
I think there must be some mistake.
I think not. You once ran an inn in Montfermeil, and you later lived as Jondrette in a hovel in the Gorbeau tenement.
Who am I talking to?
You know who I am.
I'm not saying nothing that might incriminate myself. It's not me that's a thief and a murderer.
What proof do you have that this Jean Valjean did these things?
Well, perhaps sir would like to take a look at this piece of cloth. Eh? I ripped that from the victim's jacket. See the blood on it?
Now Marius has him.
Wait here.
I'm at your service.
I shall only be a moment.
Take your time, sir. Take your time. Patience, Thénardier. Patience. Baron.
Now, may I see that material?
You may.
Just as I thought. Do you deny that this is a perfect match?
Where did you get that coat?
The victim you saw over this so-called murderer's shoulder was none other than the person you see before you now.
If it were possible for any more colour to drain from Thénardier's cheeks, then they would pale at this.
I shall arrange to pay you 1,000 francs for the service you did for my father all those years ago. The money should get you to Panama City and as far away from Paris as it is possible to be.
But what about that criminal Jean Valjean?
You may either leave by the door or I shall arrange to have you thrown out.
That afternoon, the all-pervading murkiness gives way to a few spots of sunshine.
Did you get the money, Dad?
Shut up, Azelma, and come with me.
Where are we going?
To book a passage to Panama City.
You got it then, brilliant!
Not exactly, but don't let that worry you. We're on our way to America, where they know how to reward honest, hard-working businessmen.
Someone's happy.
Don't I say so myself? I am, Azelma. I couldn't be happier if I tried. Etc. Etc.
Cosette!
What is it, my love?
Get your hat and coat and meet me outside. The coach is waiting.
Where are we going?
Oh, I've been such a fool! Such a fool!
There now. Isn't it better to have a little food inside you, sir?
You've been very good to me too, sir. And I don't know that I've ever properly thanked you in all these years.
Thank me, sir? There's nothing to thank me for.
Take good care of the silver candlesticks when I'm gone.
Where are you off to now?
I feel very close to God, too, sir.
You took a nasty fall, sir. That's all. There's no need to get gloomy.
I'm not in the least gloomy, my dear Toussaint. Those candlesticks were given to me by a very holy man, the Bishop of Dean. All day I've sensed his presence near me.
Sensed his presence, sir?
Toussaint! Toussaint!
Cosette!
Tell her to go away. I don't want her to see me like this. I'll go upstairs.
You stay where you are.
Cosette! Oh, Toussaint! I can't tell you how I missed you. Come in, come in. Let me look at my lovely girl. Marius and I would like you to come and live with us.
What's going on?
Cosette and I, we must speak with you, sir. First of all, may I offer you my most sincere apologies and thanks?
I don't understand.
I know who it was that saved me from the barricades and dragged me through the sewers to safety.
I did what I had to. There's nothing to thank me for.
Oh, but there is, sir. There is so much to thank you for.
Marius has told me everything. Father, you are a better man than you could possibly know. But you are sick. Is this why you haven't been to see me?
Only you knew how I've longed for you to call me father again. My darling Cosette.
I shall always call you father. We must get a doctor. Marius.
At once, my love. Let me help you, sir.
It's too late for that, I fear. Will you do me a service, Baron?
Anything.
You make good use of your wife's money. It was honestly earned and should be honestly spent.
I know, sir. I am ashamed of myself for ever doubting you.
Were you really a mayor of a town, Father?
I was. The town of Montreuil-sur-Mer.
And is that where you met my mother?
Your mother's name was Fantine, and she loved you with all her heart, Cosette.
If she loved me, why did she give me away?
She trusted the Thénardiers to take care of you. Believe me, Cosette, no mother loved her child as Fantine loved you. It was only mortal illness which kept you from her.
The lamp burns brightly, but nothing seems to outshine the look of radiance beaming from Jean Valjean's face.
Remember, I loved you, Cosette.
Let us help you, please.
My time is done.
As the day gives way to night, and the first lights flicker in the houses of Paris, Jean Valjean shuts his eyes, and as a tiny bird in springtime soars above the roofs and houses, so Jean Valjean soars above all the sorrows and joys of his extraordinary life.
I have only one more thing to say.
A profound and penetrating stillness suffuses the room. Jean Valjean appears transformed, transfigured.
What is it, sir?
What is it, Father? What were you going to say?
And as the old man's breath becomes lighter and lighter, he gently whispers,
"Always remember, my children, that to love is to act."
Les Misérables by Victor Hugo was dramatized by Sébastien Bonchkiewicz and Lynn Coughlin. Roger Allam was Jean Valjean, Joss Ackland was Victor Hugo, and Lucy Wybrow was Cosette. Jonathan Forbes played Marius, David Schofield was Javert, and Leslie Fitz-Javert, and Leslie Fitz-Javert, and Leslie Fitz-Javert, and Leslie Fitz-Javert.